Oh, hello, Honky Tonks. How are you? Nice to see.
Good morning, sir. You seem to be in high spirits.
Oh, I am. I love being by the sea. I absolutely love it a little bit.
Go on.
Yes. I've written a little poem about it. Would you like to hear it?
Not really.
Then you shall. Now, let me see. It goes like this. It's great to be by the sea again. In London, you get paler and paler. It brings such a lovely pink flush to your cheeks when you're chased up the pier by a sailor. I see you, sorry.
Can I help you, madam?
Oh, I'm looking for a postcard to send to my sister.
Oh, how about this one? Lovely view across the bay.
How dare you show me a disgusting thing like that?
What do you mean?
Well, look at that rock. I bet I know what's going on behind there. I believe you, they shouldn't.
Well, how about this one?
Don't give up, do you? You're still out. I've heard about the lighthouse keeper's daughter. She's no better than she should be.
Now, look here, miss. If you find these objectionable, all I can say is you must be a sex maniac.
Well, I like that. Who is it that's showing me the disgusting photographs? Are you married?
Why?
Well, I'm looking for the nice young man, you see. Excuse me, officer.
Yes?
Have any of the local girls been insulted this morning?
Not that I know of.
Any houses set on fire or dogs kicked in the harbour?
Certainly not.
That's funny. I wonder where the lads have got to.
Right, I'll have that cabin door repaired and all the other little jobs done for you, miss.
Oh, thank you.
Is there anything else needs doing?
Well, I don't know anything about boats. Only my fiancé said he wanted it ready by the end of the week.
Oh, leave it to me. I'll have you up on the slips tomorrow. Now, how would you like your upper work painted white?
Pardon?
At the same time, I could scrape your bottom and slap a couple of coats of varnish on it.
Oh, you are awful. But I like you.
No, I'm awfully sorry, darling. No, we're frantically busy in the office. No, this thing is going to take the whole weekend. There's not a tope in hell of getting home. Yeah, I know, it's an absolute bore being married to a chap like me. Yeah. Well, I shall miss you too, darling. Yes. But, no. I won't be in my own office. We're going to lock ourselves away in the conference room, take the phone off the hook. Yeah. Oh, first thing Monday, with any luck. Yeah. Oh, I'd love to you too, darling. Yeah. Well, till Monday. Bye. Bye. You, Sandra? Oh, darling, what are you doing here so soon? I hadn't expected you yet.
I couldn't wait to get my hands on you, so I caught an earlier train.
Why didn't you phone from the station? I'd have been down for you like a shot.
I tried to, but your phone was engaged.
Engaged.
Where do you want this, love?
Oh, how very kind of you. Just put it down anywhere, please.
How much do I owe you?
Oh, no, Jeremy, you misunderstand. This gentleman isn't a taxi driver.
Oh, no. Oh, blimey, no. I'm no cabbie. No. I'm a sort of a knight errand, you know. Helping a damsel in distress.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And I went down to the station to pick up the wife, and I saw this young lady walking down the lane in the dark, like, you know.
And he very kindly stopped and offered me a lift.
Well, yeah. As I said to the wife, I must take the advice of the Good Samaritan. So I did, and here she is, safe and sound.
Well, I can only say I'm very grateful.
Of course you are.
Well, it really is terribly kind of
you. Yeah, well, I'm like that, you know. Do you know, I've probably done more good turns for people than you've had hot dinners. I'm one of the best, I am. Heart of gold, salt of the earth.
Yeah, well, I'm sure you're right.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, well, we mustn't keep you. Thank you again.
Do you know, during the war in Burma, there was this Japanese soldier, and he was lying wounded in the battlefield, and he was shouting out, Tommy! Tommy! Give us a drink, will ya? Only in a Japanese accent. So I got out my slit trent and went and gave him a drop. You see, gave him a drop of water.
Well, I think that was frightfully decent of you, don't you, darling?
Yes, I think it was terribly kind.
See, I'm a prince amongst men, I am. You know, I'm very thoughtful. Prince amongst men, I am.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, this is all frantically interesting, yeah. Mr...
Humble. Charlie. Humble by name, humble by nature.
Well, thank you for telling us, and good night.
Is that beam real?
Yes, it is.
Oh, champagne, eh? I bet you don't do this every time the missus comes out for the weekend.
Well, no. As a matter of fact, I don't.
Oh, you celebrated something, then?
Yes, that's right.
Oh. Well, what do you celebrate?
It's our anniversary.
It's her birthday.
Oh, you were married on her birthday?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. What's next door, then?
The bathroom.
The kitchen.
Oh. Two in one, eh? That's very novel. You can wipe your back down with a tripe and eat sponge and onions.
Now, look here, Mr...
Humble.
Yeah. Well, my wife has had a long journey, and she's probably very hungry, sir, if you don't mind.
Oh, well. Blow, blow, thou winter wine. Thou art not so unkind as man's ingratitude. Ta-da. Yeah, do you know what? I don't think you two are married.
What?
You're having a bit on the side.
How dare you?
You're having a dirty weekend, aren't you? Both of you, together.
I say, you're not one of those blasted private detectives, are you?
No, I told you, I'm a lovely bloke. I'd tear me right arm off for a mate.
What the hell does it matter to you whether we are married or not?
I don't like to see the marriage vows made a mockery of. There are probably thousands of vicars up there all planning to get their own back on you. One of these days you'll walk down a road and a box of communion wine will drop off and eat you on the napper.
Now, listen, you oaf. I've had just about enough of you and your ignorant mouthings.
Ah, the trouble with you toffs is you've got no morals. Not like us working blokes.
I wish you'd go away and stop interfering in our affairs.
Am I not my brother's keeper? What would your dear old grey-haired mum say if she thought you were having a bit of hanky-panky with him? She'd cry into her knitting, poor old soul.
My poor old soul of a mother has a blue rinse and lives in the south of France with an Argentinian polo player.
Oh, really? Well, I had a sister like you once. A lovely girl she was. Married a plumber. Nice fella. They lived in Parsons Green.
What the hell has this got to do with us?
And she met this Burke from the West End. A tattooist he was. Had a parlour in Soho.
Really? What happened?
For God's sake, don't encourage the swine. We'll never get rid of him.
I can't help it. I'm a woman. I must know. What happened?
He used her. To practice on. He doodled all over her. From head to foot, she was half covered in flags of all nations, Arthur Loves Mary and up the buffs. And when there wasn't a square inch of skin left, he discarded her, looking like the inside of a telephone box.
Fascinating.
Oh.
And I had a brother like him. A dirty, rotten, low-down...
All right, that is enough. Now, if you're not out of here in 10 seconds flat, I am going to punch you right on the nose.
Well, you do, and I shall only turn the other cheek. Don't you realise I'm trying to do you two a good turn?
Do you know, in some ghastly, perverted sort of way, I actually think he means it.
Well, never mind, darling. You just go into the bedroom while I chuck him out.
No, I can't. The magic's all gone. Our first lovely, romantic weekend together. And he's destroyed it. Jeremy, drive me back to London immediately.
Oh, Sandra, darling, wait. You swine.
Don't worry, son, I'll lock the cottage up for you. Well, what do you think of our little love nest, darling?
Nice.
Yeah. Better than that motel. One thing, your husband won't be able to find us here.
anybody here, please? Very good. Oh, what have you done to your head? What have these people done to you? What have they done to you?
Indians!
Indians? Oh, no, no. I promise you, they're not from Bombay.
No. Only a joke, sir. Only a joke. Oh. Here we are. 30 pence a piece. Keep the party in fits. Always good for a laugh.
Oh, that is what I'm looking for. A good laugh. Lots of jolliment.
Right, you've come to the right place, sir. Yes. Springer's Joke Emporium.
Mm-hmm. Oh, very good.
Keep the party in fits. Yes. Now, have you anything particular in mind?
Well, me and my very good friends, you see, we are trying to raise some money for the community centre, you see. And we are wanting to give a little entertainment. A little entertainment.
And you're wondering what to do to tickle their fancy.
No, no. We don't want to tickle anybody's anything. No, no.
And how can I help you, sir?
Well, you see, the other day on the television box, I saw this jolly fellow, very jolly fellow, and he had this little wooden man on his lap. And they were having a conversation. And the little wooden man was saying very saucy things. Very saucy.
Oh. Oh,
very saucy things.
Yes. He was a vent.
A what?
A ventriloquist. Now, I've got just the thing you need. Now then, where's that doll? Oh! Here we are. What do you think of him? Cocky Jim, we call him.
Oh, he is very beautiful, yes. He's very lovely, isn't he? Yes,
Do you want to have a go with him?
Oh, yes, I would very much like to indeed, yes. Will you show me how he works, yes?
Yeah, but very nice. Now, you put your hand through that hole in the back there, see?
Yeah, yes.
And all the controls are in there.
Oh, yes, well, I am enjoying this very much indeed. Very nice.
That's right. Now, don't forget, his name's Cocky Jim.
Cocky Jim. Good morning, Cocky Jim. Good morning, Cocky Jim. This one is broken, you know. It doesn't say anything at all. Let me speak.
None of them do.
But this other one, he was saying things 45 to the dozen all the time, talking all the time.
Yeah, but you see, it's the man working it who does the speaking.
Oh, no, no, that is impossible, because the little man was singing My Yiddish Mama, while the big man was drinking a pint of beer and smoking a big cigar at the same time. Yes, very good.
Yeah, well, I must admit it takes a bit of practice. Mm. Go on, try again.
Oh, very well, yes. Good morning, Cocky Jim. Good morning, Mr. Patel. He sounds like me. Would you, have you any other thing that would cause hilarious amusement? You know, because...
Well, now, what about the old novelties? They're always good value, they are. Now, look at this.
Oh, yes.
The naughty Parisian telescope.
Oh, yes.
25 pence. Oh, your pals can't wait to have a look through this. Oh.
Oh, that's very funny indeed, yes. Please, have you got one that makes white rings?
Yeah, I see what you mean. I know. The monster spider terrify your family and friends.
Oh, no, 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 no. In Bombay, we call those money spiders.
You're difficult, you are, yes, but I'm not going to be beaten. I know. What you want is a good comedy act.
Oh, yes, yes. Well, you see, my friends know me as a very jocular fellow. Highly jocular.
Really?
Very jocular fellow, yes. Always laughing
all
the time.
Look, it's all in here.
Yes.
Right, we'll pick one out at random, all right?
Very good.
Yeah. Right, now then. Listen to this. This is funny, this is. A man goes out shooting in the woods. And this beautiful young blonde comes up to him. And she says, good morning, I'm game. So he shot her. I'm game, so he shot her.
Why are you laughing?
That's a joke, isn't it? I'm game.
Oh, no, no, that is very cruel, very cruel. Very cruel indeed.
Why?
Well, this innocent young lady, she goes up to this man to pass the time of day, and without a word or warning, he murders her. That is a dreadful thing to know, dreadful, dreadful thing. No, I don't like that, no.
Yes, well, I mean, if you put it like that, it's you're right, it's a terrible joke. You know what? You're too serious for comedy.
I think what you want to do is something really sensational. Give your audience a thrill.
Oh, yes, I would like that very much indeed. Please show me, yes.
Right.
Very nice. Oh, what are you doing with that gun, Pete?
Would you believe it's possible for a man to catch a bullet in his teeth that's been fired from this rifle?
No, no, I wouldn't, and I don't want to see it.
It's all right. It's a trick. It's a trick.
A trick?
Yeah, I'll show you how it's done. Look. Now then, take this rifle, right? And aim right there. There's no danger.
Are you quite certain you want me to do this?
Yeah, I'll do it every week. Look, I've got the real bullet in my hand.
Oh, well, in that case, I will do it, yes. I will play your little game.
All right, then, go on. Aim right there.
Right. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Good.
There you are, you see? I took...
Good morning.
Good morning.
What can I get for you, dear?
Gin and lime, please. A large one.
Of course. Just come from over the road, have you?
Yes.
Yes. We get a lot of them in here from over there, you know. From the cemetery. Not the residents, if you'll pardon the levity. But the bereaved. Lost a loved one, have you?
Yes, I have.
Do you know, the moment you walked in here dressed like that, I could have sworn you'd been in here before.
I was here the same time last year.
Was you, really?
As a matter of fact, I've been here for the past 22 years on the trot.
Good God, you have been unlucky, haven't you? Fancy losing 22 loved ones just like that, regular as clockwork.
Oh, no, it's the same one I'm visiting. It's a sort of pilgrimage.
Oh, I see. Someone you was close to?
He was the only man in my life. You'd be ever so surprised if I told you his name.
Oh, yes, famous, was he?
I'll give you a clue.
Got it. International footballer.
No, he was not. He was the one and only star of stage, screen and wireless. Lambert Simnel.
Who?
And I am his ever faithful fan and admirer. And every year on this date, I come here to pay my respects to his memory. The only one who still remembers Lambert Simnel.
Good morning. What can I get you, dear?
A large scotch, please. I've just come from over the road.
Oh, you poor soul. I know how you feel. I too am mourning.
I am utterly desolate.
So am I.
I am cast down and overwhelmed with grief.
So am I.
Well, you wallow in your own misery and I'll get on with mine.
Ah, you mustn't be like that. We mustn't quarrel. Look, us women should stick together at times like these. Look, you raise your glass and I'll raise mine. You drink to your beloved and I'll drink to mine.
All right, then.
To you.
To my own.
Lambert Simn.
You rotten cow.
Did you say Lambert Simnel?
Yes, I did.
How dare you? How dare you mention his name?
And why shouldn't I?
Because I am his greatest fan.
So am I.
I've been coming here to see him for the past 20 years.
And so have I.
Then why haven't I met you here before?
Well, it was a mistake, really.
How do you mean?
Well, Lambert's in 398, isn't he?
That's right.
Well, I've been visiting 389. Ever since 1952, I've been sobbing me heart out over a Maltese trolley bus driver from Brixton.
Poor thing. So you mustn't worry. I always bring him a lovely bunch of flowers.
Do you, dear? I always bring him fruit.
Fruit?
Yes.
Where he's gone, he can't eat, you know.
No, and he can't smell your flaming flowers, can he?
Well, I can't get over it. So there's two of us been keeping his memory alive.
Yes. Oh, he was a lovely actor, though, wasn't he?
Ah, wonderful.
Do you remember him in The Last Enema?
Now, you mean The Last Enemy?
Do I? Oh, it was a very moving film.
Personally, I shall never forget him as Nelson in Rampant Desire.
Oh, yes. When he came home from sea and made love to Lady Hamilton, his eye blazing with passion.
Wonderful.
If I was to tell you something, would you promise to keep it a secret?
Yes, of course I will.
Lambert Simnel and I were once very intimate.
You weren't.
We was.
Oh, you couldn't have been. Yes. I mean, you're just an ordinary fan, same as what I am.
Well, I'll tell you how it happened. When he was working at the studio, I used to wait outside the gate every night just to get a glimpse of him as he left in his big black Bentley. Huge it was. Oh, it wasn't half a size. And some nights it would be pouring with rain and his car would sweep by and drench me from head to foot in muddy water. But I didn't care. I used to go home and wring my clothes out into a basin and bath in it.
Oh, so would I. So would I.
Then one night I got desperate and ran out in front of his car and waving my hand and saying, Lambert, I love you.
Oh, and what did he do?
He ran over me and broke my arm.
Oh, you lucky devil.
Yes. But he was a true gentleman. Do you know, when I was in the hospital, he sent me a note. And I've kept it with me from that day to this. Two cost of repairing one headlamp, 17 and six.
Oh, wasn't he marvellous?
Oh, yes. It was tragic the way he went there, wasn't it?
Oh, tragic. Especially as it was our fault. I mean, it was us fans who killed him.
Yes, there were thousands of us outside the hotel, all shouting up at him, come out, Lambert, come out, we love you.
And up there, on the fifth floor, yes, the curtains of his room were flung aside, and darling Lambert rushed out to wave to us.
No balcony.
Still, dear, never mind. We've got each other now.
Yes, my love, and together alone we can keep alive the memory of Lambert.
Dry sherry, please. Happy memories to you, dear Lambert Simnel.
Help it off, will you?
Yeah, all right.
Blimey. Dear. Fine backup diver you turned out to be.
Honestly, Arthur Musgrove, I'm getting sick and tired of you. I am. You and your stupid hobbies. Oh, I mean, it was bad enough, wasn't it? When we was hunting foxes on Hammersmith Broadway. But this is the last straw.
You'll be laughing the other side of your face when I get that treasure up.
What treasure?
The treasure out of the Spanish galleon. I'll get it up. I'll find it. Don't worry.
Not in the Serpentine, you won't. Oh, Arthur, what would a Spanish galleon be doing in the middle of Hyde Park, I ask you?
Ah, don't be silly. It wasn't called the Serpentine when they were sailing about.
Oh.
The tide used to come up past Selfridges. What if I call it Bayswater? Anyway, it's all down the pirates, Matt.
Pirates, Matt?
Yeah.
You got that off the back of a packet of cornflakes. There must be millions of them.
All right, then. Who was it that was worked out it was 38 steps due north from Dead Man's Tree to the middle of the Serpentine. Go on, answer me that. Answer me that. Go on, answer.
Oh, all right. You did.
Well, I must have been the only one because there was nobody else down there.
Well, all I can say, Arthur, is that I have never felt such a fool in all my life as I did today.
What are you talking about?
Why did you have to go and harpoon that rowing boat?
Well, I thought it was a shark.
A shark? Whoever saw a shark with red and white oars and 49 painted on its nose?
Well, you never know what sort of perils are lurking about in the deep.
And another thing, I mean, look, why do I have to come along with you dressed up like this?
Supposing I got my lifeline tangled up in the rigging.
What rigging?
The rigging of the Spanish galleon.
All right, then. What am I supposed to do, supposing you had?
Stick a knife in your teeth and dive down and cut me loose, that's what.
I can't even swim.
That's right, that's right. Pour cold water on everything I say. You don't give me credit for nothing, you don't. Now, don't I always try and choose an hobby that you can join in, darling? Do you take part in?
Yes, well, sometimes I don't want to be a part of it, see? I mean, I'm afraid to show my face round the church ever since you took up with this diving lark.
What do you mean?
I happen to know what roof the lead for them boots come off of.
Yeah, well, I'd like to see him prove it, that's all.
Say, listen, Arthur, it wasn't quite so bad, was it, when we was pearl diving up the reservoir? I mean, well, we could walk there. But now it's the Serpentine, we've got to go on the underground.
Yeah. And I've got a bone to pick with you about that underground.
Oh, yes. I thought you'd throw that up in my face.
Well, what a daft thing to do. Fancy letting me get on the escalator and start going down before you got that pram through the turnstile.
Well, I thought you'd see.
Well, how can I? There's no window in the back of my helmet. That hose pipe don't stretch no far, you know. No sooner had I got foot on the platform, the whoosh, I was back up outside the station again buying another paper.
Well, I did pay for you to come back in again.
Yeah, but all you got to do is sit on the train and keep pumping the air. Well, I'm the one who has to face the danger. Well, I'm the one who got the bends going through open station.
Still, it was a record for you, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the deepest you've ever been.
Yeah, I suppose it was, really.
Here, Arthur. There's another thing. I want that octopus out of my bathroom.
Now, how am I going to get acclimatised to monsters of the deep if I get rid of that octopus?
I don't care. I don't like being in the same bath with it. It don't keep its tentacles to itself.
That octopus is a female.
Well, that's as may be. All I can say is nobody seems to have told it.
Oh, good afternoon, madam. PC Turner. Oh, yes, I think you're the gent I'm looking for. Arthur Musgrove, is it?
That's right.
Were you indulging in a bit of deep-sea diving in the Serpentine earlier today, sir?
That is correct.
And during your perambulations along the bottom of the said Serpentine, did you by any chance remove or otherwise take away any object or thing?
I did not.
Arthur, of course you did. Here.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Yeah, that's right.
Well, in that case, sir, I must warn you that anything you say will be taken down and may be used in evidence.
Why, what have I done?
What have you done?
Yeah.
You've only flooded the Albert Hall and half-drowned the London Symphony Orchestra, that's all.